Hello everybody, Heflamok here, casting with Mr. Grandis, we from Hefla TV. Yellow Submarine versus Lemon Dogs, that's on our schedule right now. It's already the second game. For those who joined a bit late here, Yellow Submarine is one game ahead. Lemon Dogs were more Lemon Kittens in the last game because they did definitely not show the full potential they can play. If that's gonna change in game 2, that's what we're gonna find out. We are listening and watching, of course, the Hitbox Challenger here by Eraser. Let's go, Grandis.
A great performance coming up from Yellow Sub in game number one. In particular, the Ember Spirit in mid crushed his lane. Of course, there was a little bit of rotation in from their supports, but for the most part, he handled that lane 1v1 versus the Puck and did so very well. Really good turns, knowing the limits of the hero, and it was a pleasure to watch. We're going to see Beastmaster banned out in the first stage coming out from Lemon Dogs, and I'm not surprised. The Beastmaster in IO is so scary to go up against, but with those bans, we're going to see Lashrak left through to the first pick stage, and Yellow Submarine will be very happy to get their hands on it.
Yep, Lemon Dogs do not focus on calls like last game. That means there's still a Lashrak, there's still a Gyrocop, there's still a Shadow Fiend, whatever they want to go for. Yellow Submarines, with their one pick available pretty much after the initial buns, they go directly for the Lashrak, securing this one. Even though the Ember Kling worked out very, very well, Yellow Submarines showed that you don't have to go for the cookie cutter meta build at this moment to rock a show. They were looking so good, even with those relatively surprising picks on the course.
Yeah, well, as far as Lemon Dog's next couple of selections this game, even though it didn't work great for them in game number one, I think they'll probably fall back on the Tusk again. It's something that they're comfortable with and in general is a good hero, even though it didn't pan out in the first game. I think they'll give it another shot, but instead, ooh, that's a Nyx Assassin, a very early one from Lemon Dog, so maybe it's not going to be a Tusk after all. Really good against the Lashrak when it comes to mana burn later on in the game, but I think they could have left this Nyx till later on in their draft. That's just my opinion.
Yep, the Nyx Assassin is pretty much the direct counter against Lashrak. It's a hero that scales very nicely. It's something you can put in the offlane, someone that is your initiator, massive stuns if, of course, done right in the right situation. Choke points as well as massive teamfights where they all align. But yeah, the mana burn, for example, scaling very well on the Lashrak, and you can stop a lot of pursuits, especially on the Lashrak because of all his AoE. Like, you cannot stop yourself as a Lashrak. Like, once you unload everything, you will hit the next assassin and you might just stun yourself while you're trying to pursue and maybe get the next lightning in whatsoever. Tusk is also coming out, so Lemon Dogs at the moment, they're focusing on just those utility heroes. Yellow Submarine is putting one on top of that with the Winter Wyvern, and we go directly into the second buns, and I think now that Yellow Submarine saw that Lemon Dogs did just go for the utility heroes, I think we're gonna see some more core bans out. Gyrocopter, Shadow Fiend, one of them, unless they wanna go for them themselves. That might be, of course, one thing, but no, they don't want to see a bounty hunter. Okay, understandable.
And then a Clink Span from Lemon Dogs. They want to have nothing to do with game number one. We shouldn't see Ember Spirit banned out, but my goodness, these bans from Lemon Dogs, it shows that they were very afraid of what Yellow Submarine were bringing to the table in the first game.
Absolutely. So that is more or less a respect ban. I still suspect one of the calls of the common core at the moment getting banned out, but then again, like, it's so open at this point. Just one core given away and the rest is completely open. Yeah, the Shadow Fiend is out, which leaves the Gyrocopter still on the table for the physical ones, for the most common physical one at this point. A PL at the moment would not be worth banning, I think. It's just, he's not that common, but it's for both teams still an option.
Well, let's wait and see. Yeah, it's still plenty of heroes available towards either side. Lemon Dogs, already with an assassin on the table, will be a little bit more hesitant to pick up those spellcasty supports to follow up the Winter Wyvern, but at the moment, something like a Phantom Lancer could work really well for them, as Lemon Dogs really would struggle to actually lock him down and keep him in place. Tusk and Nyx Assassin are anything but reliable when it comes to that regard. Very little wave clear, outside of just their nukes, which aren't that amazing.
Absolutely. So, well, they hesitate at this point, Lemon Dogs. The drafter was a tiny bit AFK. They're gonna ban out a Broodmother, something they don't want to deal with. That means Lemon Dogs is preparing a draft that is very single target focused instead of like going for the AoE, even though the Zeus would be, of course, someone that is actually quite nice against the Broodmother because you give vision, obviously, and the damage. You as a Broodmother hiding somewhere in the trees, you always get stuck because the Zeus is damaging you on a great AoE. Yellow Submarine, going for the Plutzik. I'm not a big fan of it, especially it's the direct answer to Zeus. And Zeus is one of those heroes who can stop a Bloodseeker really, really fast. He's always hoping for that Blood Rage uphill, but he's sometimes just not getting it through. And he underestimates how less of a HP pool he has sometimes, especially against burst damage like this. I mean, what do we have here? Ice Shard, Snowball, Zeus Ultimate, Nyx Assassin, maybe before initiated, boom, that was already it. Or any other combination right now from Lemon Dogs would just obliterate that Bloodseeker.
Even though it's going to be a hard game for the Bloodseeker, the only thing harder than playing the Bloodseeker this game is playing against it when you're dealing with that raw amount of burst damage and the Zeus Bloodseeker combo. I think this third pick for Yellow Submarine functions as somewhat a third ban for them, and it's going to be their safe lane farmer. Although BKB is mandatory this game, once he picks it up, Bloodseeker is still going to be a very severe threat. With the amount of damage that Lushrak can front load, Bloodseeker is still very scary to be playing against, even if you have these burst tools at your disposal. It's not going to be the easiest Bloodseeker game we've ever seen, but it's still going to be a nuisance, and I'm a little bit afraid for Lemon Dogs in the laning stage in particular. The Zeus might be going mid, and if he is, he's going to get dominated by the Lushrak, I want to say. But no, instead, Lemon Dogs will pick up the Viper. That's going to help things out a little bit for them. Having that tanky frontliner, the hero that does so much damage to the Bloodseeker and is fairly resistant to Lushrak's burst if he gets a substantial amount of farm. So yeah, a good pick for Lemon Dogs.
I definitely like it. The Viper here against this one, like, no, I mean, no, okay. There's of course, less damage by the Lashrak, a lot less, even, like, the Plutrite, he kind of ignores that Splinter Blast by the Winter Viper, and he mitigates a lot of damage right here, and Yellow Submarine for them, it's a lot harder to chase, because you're automatically slowed if the Viper is somewhere in the front lines. The entire thing is then, of course, on top of, for example, the Sigil. Like, Sigil and Viper, that adds kind of up, again, like, movement speed reduction, attack speed reduction, etc. You also have the Spike Carapace to deal with that might stun multiple heroes. So these fights, they're gonna happen with all these auras around, and that's, of course, a downside for Yellow Submarine. They secure the Earthshaker, a hero that was banned last game relatively early for the simple reason that he's so good in laning. Like, I mean, he is the offlane killer if he gets the right Fisher up, where you completely block them and then you just really clop them down by single right clicks.
Although he could, in theory, kill off the Nyx Assassin this game, I think he's going to be sitting for the most part behind the Lushrak. It's one of the scariest lanes to go up against. Although a little bit less so on the Dire side, it's harder to find those angles for the Fissures, and it's a little bit awkward when it comes to rotating around. Earthshaker, or Lushrak, whenever he's backed up by that Earthshaker, is a force to be reckoned with. Even something like a Viper can't stand up against that. If he gets caught in the combination between both of those heroes, corrosive skin or not, he's going to take a lot of damage, if not just outright die.
Absolutely, and now, well, it's about the fifth ban, Darkseer. So, they don't think that this Earthshaker is going to be offline Earthshaker. Otherwise, they would never ban the Darkseer. So, they expect this Earthshaker to be around the Bloodseeker and the Winter Wyvern. And on top of that, they're going to go for another offliner. There would be a Clockwork if they want that. The Clockwork is actually not a bad pick, I think, here for Yellow Submarine.
Clockwork's hardly ever a bad pick. He's just really good in general. If it's not the Clockwork, Spiritbreaker also comes to mind, but you know, there's a lot of flexibility for Yellow Submarine in their offlane. They have a lot of options. For Lemon Dogs, this pick is it could be anything, if I'm honest. There's really nothing telling about Lemon Dogs' lanes. Their heroes are very flexible, but at the same time, I don't think that they're very good in lane outside of the Viper. Tusk can apply a decent amount of pressure, but no, just wait and see. I think their supporting duo is going to be very awkward. Something like a Tusk Zeus support duo.
Yeah, Clockwork would still be your option. Getting the Undying out, I guess, that prevents them to go for dual lanes. That would still be your option for Yellow Submarine, so that's not going to happen. For Lemon Dogs, they already have enough utility, I think. The Zeus in the mid, the Viper in the mid, both could work out. They get a Rubick on top of that. I don't think I like this, actually. I mean, of course, the Fisher is a good steal. Winter's Curse would be a nice steal, but it's really hard to get. Rupture and Plutrite. No, I'm not a big fan of this Rubick.
In general, I think the Rubick this game, although he's a great hero, I don't think that it rounds out Lemon Dog's lineup nicely enough. They have a lot of mid-game pressure and a lot of early-game damage that they can pump through, but if Yellow Submarine can just delay this game, and with Earthshaker Wyvern, that's a definite possibility. the scaling damage just isn't there for Lemon Dogs. Zeus is okay, as it goes later with his passive, but it just doesn't compare to a farmed Bloodseeker and a farmless Shrek. If they get their BKBs up and running, Lemon Dogs are hardly going to have anything to answer this. I think Yellow Submarine's draft in general is just a little bit better, especially if we see this Zeus going towards mid lane. I can see him having a terrible time. Zeus against the Earthshaker Lesh is almost a death sentence.
Yeah, pretty much. I would have liked that Clockwork, to be honest, but Spirit Breaker just does similar things. Obviously, the charge is more or less just a slower way of hookshotting someone, right? So let's just go for this. When it comes to the Spirit Breaker, I think he's gonna have a decent time if he charges at the pretty much the time when Lemon Dogs have pretty much none of their cooldowns left, like the stun, spike, carapace, etc. Telekinesis on cooldown, the Rubik has also become an easy target. Snowball on cooldown. The same goes for the Tusk. Of course, he suffers also from the Viper and everything else that reduces attack speed. Of course, the 17% there, the Crater Bash really just works nicely if and when you have a nice attack speed. Anyway, let's really introduce them fast, starting here with Miroshka on the Bloodseeker. We have Nordsic playing the Winter Wyvern. Kant is on the Earthshaker behind him. Getrox on the Spiritbreaker I just mentioned, and I think Barash is on the Lash Shark. By the way, Barash, is that really like, is that a Russian G? Is it Bagash?
I have no idea. Like, I'm not the one to ask.
No, because sometimes they write it in Cyrillic, sometimes they write it in Latin, but some of the letters are similar. For example, Miroshka, that's not Miposhka, because that's how you write the Russian R. But there's also a way to write it in Cyrillic, so it's very confusing. Either way, let's just look at the other side.
On the Radiant Cliff, all eyes on Jollum. He's spinning around in circles, throwing Mario coins in the air. He's going to be flying under Zeus. Eris Loco on the Rubik. Steph Style on the Tusk. Nyx Assassin handled by Krilly. And Viper, last but not least, by their stand. And I'll let you pronounce that name as well.
Vatsum Hest. I think that's some Swedish thing that actually has probably some meaning, but That's too much for me, actually. I could look it up, but later.
Well, let's go out into these lanes. Nyx Assassin is going to be soloing the offlane for the Radiant side. Mid lane matchup is Zeus versus Lesh. We already kind of touched on it. This Zeus versus Lesh matchup is not going to be pretty for Jollum. The good news is that he does get a good block, so he's going to be up on his cliff. But Lashrak, once he starts getting sufficient levels, the Zeus is under constant pressure. He has to come pretty close to try and CS, and he's going to be constantly spamming out his nukes. And although Zeus can, in theory, kill off the Lashrak with good rotations in from the supports, it's still de facto a Lashrak win. Bottom line, Spirit Breaker is going to be going up against the Viper, Tusken, and Rubik. Not a very good lane for Spirit Breaker at all.
Yep. By the way, if we have any Swedish people in the chat, like, maybe you can actually help me, because, like, vad, I know that's, like, what in Swedish. Like, som is, I don't know, something along the lines how. In hells, is like, the best, like, very good or something like that. But it doesn't make any sense if you add that all up, but maybe some Swedish people just can educate it. You can tweet it to me. Tweet it to me, and I will definitely read it out, even in the cast if I see it in time. So, back to the Dota thing. Just checking if there's some linguists in the chat.
For now, nothing too interesting happening. Bloodseeker is farming freely up against the Nyx Assassin, kind of as to be expected. Not much pressure. Nyx can apply Hero, although Nyx is getting good experience. And he'll throw out a stun every once in a while. He'll be able to sustain through this indefinitely with the Blood Rage applied to himself. Lashrak is farming very well in mid, but for now, so is the Zeus. It's a pretty even trade there, and oh, Snowball on bottom. This could get interesting. On to the Spirit Breaker. They'll wall him off with the Ice Shards, and now start walking him down. The poison attack working. Spirit Breaker needs to charge out of this, but he can't since there's a lift from Eris Loco. They'll lift him up. This time around, he's going to try for the charge. I think they held on to that lift, or needed to hold on to that lift, for a little while longer.
Oh, look at this. Jollum actually stoked here. Kant coming in. There's actually stun on... Oh, two, but I think they don't have enough punch here anymore. Well, the Urshak is still following up. He has now enough for a Fissure, but still 3 seconds cooldown. Krilly still, he has the Spike Carapace just in case. And Kant turning around. The Zeus, actually, that would be interesting if the Lashrock was still part of this fight, but he's not. There's a nice stun here. Kant getting a lot of damage, and that is our first blood. It looked so good by Yellow Submarine, but in the end they were just running out of steam. The Lashrak just taking too much damage and having no mana and also no means to restore mana. And therefore, yeah, that fight had to be cancelled really fast.
Yeah. If Lishrak had his bottle available, maybe things get interesting inside that mid-skirmish, but that's going to help out Lemon Dogs quite a bit, especially since it was the Zeus to pick up that first blood. It's going to give him quite a significant advantage when it comes to his farm in the mid lane, already running with a magic stick, boots, and bottle, and compare that to the Lishrak, just having his bottle flying out now. Yeah, things will go back to the way they were, no big rotations, and I don't think we'll see any, especially since the bottom runes and illusion, not too interesting there. But with the Rubick Lift, things could get scary for Bresh. He's going to be pulled back into the Zeus's burst damage, and oh, turning around, Fissure is there, but he might just drop to this right-click damage and one more chain. That's going to be the death of the track with a snowball in. They'll go into the Earthshaker. Ice Shards won't wall him off perfectly, but it's more than enough to secure the double kill for this Zeus. Even though on paper, 1v1 versus Lishrak, Zeus should struggle. These support rotations have been on point from Lemon Dogs.
Absolutely, beautifully locked in. And also, Getrox is getting more and more trouble here. Charges on cooldown. We have a level 2 poison attack, which is very, very uncommon. Getrox, however, wants to go for the Viper. Is there some rotation coming in? No, nobody is really TPing. Viper went for the Trank Boot, but there is the charge, as well as the Fissure at the same time. And now 17%, that's all you need. And he gets it! He gets it right there. Is there a second one? No, but he still has vision. There is a Bloodseeker on them. They just have to go for it. Only problem is, of course, he is slowed by that awesome ability called Corrosive Skin. So do they have enough? No, can't. Well, he needs 5 more mana. 5 more mana is everything that holds him back from getting that kill on the Viper, but at the moment he's blocked in by those nice little ice shards. Can't. He's not doing anything. Now he has the mana, he turns around, does not get the kill on the Viper, no vision whatsoever, and now he's the one just going down Tusk. That is just pretty much one ice shard or a club in the back.
And since Viper has Tranquil Boots and a salve, he's going to get to stay in this lane. He'll go for the Spirit Breaker, and that's a fourth kill this game for the Zeus. He'll tank a little bit of tower aggro, but he's going to be just fine. No way to punish this, and he'll be able to TP home freely. This is really big for them. Interesting to see Tranquil Boots on Viper. I can't say that I've seen that ever, or if I have, it was only an isolated occurrence. But regardless, 5-0 the start for Lemon Dogs. It's looking pretty good across the map.
Yep. That means also they can apply some pressure on that tier 1 tower. At least the cliff is coming out, which means from now on any lane could push if they want to. However, I'm not really sure if that's the right thing to do at this point, because it's a bit too early. Tower's not really taking a lot of damage. Zeus had to go fully back to the base and run manually back. No TP whatsoever. Lashrak finally catching up a tiny bit, but, well, they still work on that tower.
A stun lands on the Jalam. That's going to be a kill for the Lishrak with the vision coming out from the Bloodseeker. Very easy kill. And he has a regen. As long as he can back out away from these creeps and the tower, he might even be able to turn on the Steph style. But in the absence of the Zeus, the Lishrak is getting a big farm and experience advantage. And with that kill, Lishrak is now in a really good spot. He only died once in the laning stage. And there's Steph style looking for the splinter stun. Going to miss. He'll pop his ultimate. Steph style is going to try to snowball towards creeps. Great presence of mind there from Steph style. We'll buy him a little bit more space, but is it enough? Lishrak is bottling up, has enough mana for another lightning storm, and my goodness, that Bloodseeker vision plus those rack is ridiculous. They'll bring in the Nyx, but his stun's going to miss, and another lightning storm, and they're just trying to pull everybody into this mid lane. Fissure going to help disengage for the Lash, but a couple of bolts, and this Lash is going to be put very low. They'll mana burn him through, but there's no level 6 for this Zeus, and it looks like he's going to be able to walk this one off. TP support for the Winter Wyvern is going to be cancelled, as it's not necessary, and in the meantime, Bloodseeker rotates bottom and kills off the Viper.
Yep, Viper dying here, Platzika's first rotation, while they were chasing that Lashrak in the mid, he got that kill, and it's of course a nice one. That's like a kill worth almost 600 gold right there, so absolutely worth for the Winter Wyvern as well, because he's now alone on the lane, nobody's really contesting with him. Krilling is coming back right now, and he needs the level, he needs it fast level 6 just to work with the Winter's Curse, and more interestingly, we have the Earthshaker with Invisible Rune heading towards mid, and that should be an easy kill for the Lashrak. He's rotating in right now. And now, there we go, the spam is real. It actually hits Jolem, but he's still aggressive.
There's an Earthshaker right behind him. The Zeus ultimate will be now committed. It spots out the Shaker, and that's going to be the end of that kill.
Now he knows. Oh, Lord. And, of course, I missed a kill in the meantime because that was just too interesting. Clearly, as well as Steph style, kill the Winter Wyvern here. But I really thought in the mid we're going to see some action. Now, Kunt actually going for the Zeus just the second I went for something else. The telekinesis is out and we have Eris Loco being charged, and I stay around. Barash is still coming in, and look at it, he has full vision. There's the stun, and that is a safe kill. Just the Spirit Picker, the guaranteed Crater Bash that should just do the trick. So yeah, we have pretty much equalized this entire game after a horrible start for Yellow Submarine.
Equalized.
They are back.
If you, especially if you take a look at the last hits and denies, the Bloodseeker is dominating the chart. He's doubling up the Viper. That's not something you see very often at this point. He farms very quickly with the Blood Rage as well as the Quelling Blade, but Viper shouldn't be doing better than this, and he's gonna get ruptured, bashed up, and oh, he's
wow.
Be dead now. Up in top lane, looks like there's a killer brewing onto the Winter Wyvern potentially, but Stephsile's gonna have to do this alone with no Zeus ultimate available for 30 seconds.
That was very, very impressive. I mean, you are ruptured, you get knocked to the right, you get Nether Strike to the left, as well as a Crater Bash afterwards. I think, like, only the bashes and the distance you travel with that, like, did so much damage with that rupture on the Viper, and yeah, nothing the Viper could really do in this situation. So he's back to lane, but yes, now we have even the kill score equalized, and you already said it, like, when it comes to last hits and net worth, the Bloodseekers at the moment doing
oh,
so
it's
fine.
It's gonna get even worse. They find Eris Loco charging forward. They have a Fissure. That's going to wall off the Viper, and with a bash, the Rubick will go down. However, now the Bloodseeker is going to get stunned up by the Impale, and they'll be able to get that return kill, a very important one for the Lemon Dog side, but it's not over yet. Around the corner, Krilly is going to be able to spike Carapace, the Lightning Storm, but not the stun, and Krilly is stuck in a bad corner. They'll ball both of them in with the Snowball, but Stepshell is now isolated away from the rest of his team. Winter's Curse onto the Viper. The follow-up Splinter stun is there, and this Shrek is overrunning them. That was a show of force coming out from the Lesh.
Absolutely strong plays here by Yellow Submarine. They do not like stack their stuff. They really play it one CC by the other one, perfectly executed, so they get the max disable duration out of all of this. Nice attempts here by Krilly and Co. to like save something with Spike Carapace as well as a nice snowball, but it was just too late. And now Yellow Submarine, they commit to this tower. However, well, the creeps were a tiny bit held back, but now it just should do the trick in the mid. Well, Bloodseeker stopped that Zeus from pushing. The Zeus actually. What is he going for? He went to... Ah, he just wanted to finish his Arcane Boots, which he got now. And Yellow Submarine, they don't even go for the tower. They abandon this one.
I think it's a reasonable move. They can get a lot of farm in their own woods and in the lanes. In the meantime, they've abandoned top for quite a while, and well, they're getting a lot of space. Mid lane, there's rotation in from the Tusk and the Nyx Assassin. Nyx Assassin does have Vendetta, and there is no Dire Sentry to spot out this rotation. But the Bloodseeker has an Earthshaker Wyvern behind him. He's not an easy kill by any means, and it looks like he'll back off and farm Ancients, either by smelling something up or otherwise. He's going to avoid the bullet for now, but Nyx Assassin's going to wander here. He's going to spot too many heroes to go. I'm not sure if they got eyes onto the Earthshaker. They're going to wander towards the mid lane and now change focus onto the Bloodseeker. This could get interesting with a Zeus ultimate at the ready, but oh, fight in mid, a brewing Nether Strike onto poor Zeus. He's not going to be able to get off his ultimate as he falls down. The Impale is going to miss. Krilly can't connect onto the onto the Spirit Breaker. Nice Ice Shards will fly through. We'll all have the Spirit Breaker perfectly. They'll lift him up, snowball into him, and they'll have enough damage probably, especially with the Spike Carapace. And the Spirit Breaker's killing spree is down for 420 gold.
If he would have charged through four heroes here and lived, I would have laughed so loud because that's just ridiculous. But the Spike Carapace was there just in case they do not have enough damage. He would have been straight away, say it's done. Which is, by the way, also a nice ability. If you see that there is a Spirit Breaker coming and the chart, you know the trajectory, you can actually Spike Carapace stop him, which is a cool thing if that's, for example, before in and out of a fight. So that's why I also love this ability. You can really just... yeah, use yourself as a nice bowler if you want it like that. But still, they're doing all fine. Leshrac is dual stacking, beautifully done right there. So he has now two camps to go for, and that's a lot of gold. He's heading directly for that early Bloodstone. If he had the Bloodstone already earlier with all the kills, I mean, they caught up 11 kills within 4 or 5 minutes, something like that, man. He would have so escalated with the Bloodstone charges.
Even without the escalation of Bloodstone charges, they're still out killing Lemon Dogs. They're getting better trades in all of these skirmishes, and the farm is not even close. Viper's the highest CS from Lemon Dogs. He has 40 CS. Bloodseeker almost has 80. It's pretty gross, and since Viper's gone for like his Tranquils, the Keela build, his impact this game is going to be very limited. Viper as a hero needs to dominate his lane, and 1-3-0, it's not working out for Lemon Dogs. This is very, very concerning for them just based on their team. They needed to do well in these lanes, but Yellow Sub are winning the early game, and I don't see a time in the near future that Lemon Dogs will have a convincing advantage, but yep,
Jaws. And the Nether Strike right there, like this was this time before the Rupture, but it doesn't really matter, like the Reckless should just do the trick. He gets his ultimate off, but it doesn't really help. I mean, Getrox is coming in, getting the Snowball right there, but Stephsile, they abandoned the whole thing. In the mid, however, we had a nice little fight directly. Viper versus Slashrak, and he's winning. There is a charge just to clean up, but he does the right thing. TP out because they saw Getrox coming for it.
That's a huge pickoff on the Lesh for the Viper. A lot of gold. Suddenly, after being stuck with just a Tranquil Boots of Keela, he now has his two components towards his mechanism. Viper has found a lot of space for the time being, and that's gonna help keep Lemon Dogs in this game, but still, this Zeus is not having a fun time at all whenever it comes to these large-scale engagements, but maybe they'll get a pickoff. They'll look for the Spiritbreaker, chase forward, they get the lift onto him, pull him back, but Spiritbreaker has a charge out, and Thunderbolt, not gonna cancel it, not in range, and he's gonna be just fine.
Yep, he's going away. That last one, if that connected, that might have been very interesting, but it's just not gonna happen. Still, Lemon Dogs at least find a high valuable kill on that last shark, and they keep farming here and there and establish something. Now we have a little pause. I hope this is not the... Oh my god, the team is winning, we have to DDoS it pause like we had yesterday on Lemon Dogs, actually.
I don't think so. Looks like it's just a little bit of ping.
Well, let's hope so. I'm always afraid of this kind of stuff. Like, it's just ruining the mood. Ruining the caster's mood, especially. The players, they're really tired and everything of waiting and pauses. Pauses is just destroying your rhythm. And, like, everybody who plays Dota, like, when someone comes in your room and wants something from you, and you even manage to get your team paused, you come back, and then, I don't know, it just doesn't feel the same game. And then for pro players, it's pretty much the same. That's why it's always nice to avoid pauses.
Well, we're stuck here, but we can take a look at the metrics while we've slowed down a lot. It's above a 5,000 net worth advantage for Yellow's sub, and even more than that for the experience in their favor, since they are leading in kills. Lemon Dogs still have heroes that can get pickoffs from behind, but the ability for them to take a team fight is very, very limited. I think they're going to rely on this Nyx Assassin to make good rotations and just partner up with a couple of heroes. Smokes are very important for Lemon Dogs.
Yeah, to be honest, this is not a game that Lemon Dogs really wants to take in, I don't know, into the area of very late mid game or even late game. Until then, they have to either dominate and finish it, or it's getting uglier and uglier, because that Bloodseeker will win against the Viper, I think, when we even put them 6 slots into it. And who has really late game potential? Like the Rubick, the Zeus, the Nyx Assassin or Stepstyre on a Tusk? I don't think so. Like, yes, the Zeus is gonna be crazy in damage that he can bring out, but in direct comparison to a Lushrak, I wouldn't want to trade. So, both of the cores on Yellow Submarine, I think they have a lot more late game potential, as well as the heroes they have around, and the ultimates especially. So, also the Spirit Pick is one of those heroes that can, if needed, not just go for some utility items, he can also really go for the big pricey items and then start right clicking, especially with the BKB on. He is just killing at least all your supports. So yeah, the longer this game goes, not to mention that we also have a Midas on Yellow Submarine, I don't think this is a game Lemon Dogs wants to take long.
And you're gonna have another one in the Spirit Breaker pretty soon. Compare his farm at face value to the Viper and the Zeus, and he's just smack dab in the middle of them. So the Spirit Breaker should be able to get to that point. After picking up the hand of Midas and a BKB, he's going to be almost unstoppable. From there on out, like things like Assault Cuirass, Mjolnir even, just big items for the Spirit Breaker should come out afterwards. But
That's actually a Midas. You think that's a Midas?
Yeah, 100%. That's a Midas.
Okay, that's very interesting. So two Midas rolling versus no Midas rolling, slowing down the game, going for some... I don't know, very precise and preemptive strikes on Lemon Dogs and just not letting them push. And also when it comes to push, Lemon Dogs does not have anything, absolutely not anything they could really throw at a tower for, I don't know, it's really just a shout out to DDoS's mom. That one was good. Either way, but yeah, they don't have siege abilities. It's just really bad what Lemon Dogs can throw against the tower, so that's not really the way you want to go for. They use a cliff. I don't know if that was intentional because it's a bit too early. Right? It's just a Rubick who doesn't even hit the tower and nowhere else anywhere was actually doing something to the tower, so maybe...
Tier 1 bottom is low enough to where it's going to be denied, so that cliff is going to be refreshed in just a second.
I guess, yeah. So for that reason, he really just used it against the creeps, so that's why I was a tiny bit confused. Anyway, top, they really want to do something. The Nyx Assassin has, if he wants to, the Vendetta, but the problem is... Wait, is that an Observer Ward? Yeah. It's So that happens all the time under Observer Ward, where there is an enemy sentry directly next to it. That's
interesting. It's a little bit awkward. Yeah, the Observer Ward was placed after the Sentry Ward, and they haven't actually been over towards that side to deward it. The Tusk and the Nyx are undetected until the Nyx assassin shows in lane, but we have another pause. This time it's Jollum to press the button. Or no, it's Lesh again. This is really awkward. Let's go ahead and take a look at the console and see if we can ascertain the ping of all of these players. Looks just fine. I'm not sure what's going on.
Yep, the only one who doesn't look fine is of course the Chinese caster. But that's kind of normal because we have the same ping to China than this one, and yeah. Barash is saying thank you for the DDoS. I know, it's horrible, but then again, players should be protected. So, I don't know.
There's not anything to say that hasn't been said before. Well, I think we pretty much covered the state of this game. It would be a shame if we have to do any sort of load or what have you. Yellow Sub are in a pretty good situation this game. I don't really have much else to talk about. The supports are all doing pretty poorly when it comes to their gold income. You have boots upgrade for most of them, and that's about it. So nothing interesting there, but yeah, we're just waiting until Lesh can find some resolution to his problem, whatever that might be.
Well, if really someone locked onto him for DDoSing, then there's nothing he can do except for changing IP. That's the biggest problem at this point, but he's coming back. We just have to see if it's this time all fine. Let's just hope so. Otherwise, it would really destroy my mood, because it's the second time we have that, and, well, they say G. So let's hop into this game and see if he plays and if everything seems to fine. He goes for the double camp farm here in the mid again at the moment. He doesn't really want to show. Also knowing that he could be still easily ganked, and he really wants that Bloodstone before he goes into it. But oh, look at the Spirit Breaker bottom. He has no charge whatsoever, but there is no telekinesis anymore. The Nyx Assassin wants to come in. There's no tower, so they could go for it. They go for the Impale, and wow, that's quite some damage right there. Clearly, he's just coming through it and making sure he's not charging away with the Spike Carapace. Easy kill on the Spirit Breaker. Nice chase there.
Yeah, that was a well-executed gank coming up from Lemon Dogs, and that's their way back into this game. Their heroes aren't very good flash farmers. Viper, although he does very well in lane, generally, his ability to farm in the jungle is very minimal, and same with the Zeus. Arc Lightning is okay, but it's not great up in top lane. Push is going to commence coming out from Yellow Sub. They'll amp up the Lushrak, even a level 1, and a Diebok DX can do quite a number on this tier 1 tower, but Lemon Dogs looks like they want to try and defend. However, with the Winter Wyvern embracing one of the creeps, they'll be able to take this down before there is contention. The best they can hope for is to catch him on the retreat. They might be able to do just that with the jump in from the Tusk. They'll catch a lot of stuns on the Bloodseeker. Can they focus him down beforehand? They will. The Bloodseeker will go down before he can kill off anything. Echo Slam onto the Viper. He is ruptured up, and the Viper continues walking around. He can't do much here. He'll go around the corner. The Zeus damage is immense. What Earth is going to connect onto the Rubick. The Lushrak is dying to creeps. It's 1-for-3 the trade. Lemon Dogs find a good exchange. Zeus is going to fish for the Thunderbolt, but can't find the Lesh. He's already scuttled his way out towards the right and finds a haste.
Yep, that's too bad that the Spirit Breaker was not there. Like, I think he was battling with the Nyx Assassin at the same time. Nyx Assassin helped himself into
Lesh.
Oh, yeah. Lesh, he's going for it. He knows there are still some low XP heroes there. They deward that Observer Ward. Now, there is, of course, the Lightning Ball on cooldown, so that's an easy kill for the Lashrak. Drive-by shooting. Yo, my friend. That was definitely nice timing there. The ward is gone, but getting the Zeus for it, totally worth it. That's more than the 75 gold.
Yeah, that was really smooth coming up from the Lash. And if you went mid, things could have gotten hairy. There was a Vendetta Nyx with a Vendetta hit and then a Mana Burn winning the Lashrak. So it was not only a good aggressive move, but it might have saved Lushrak's life. And with that, he's going to have his completed Bloodstone flying out to him any second now. So Yellow Sub, even though that fight starts out poorly, the Lushrak cleans up a couple of kills, and that tips the scales to where it's close to even. Still Lemon Dog's favored, but it doesn't change the state of this game much. Yellow Sub are still out farming the enemy side.
Yep, and how is it with the Midas of the Spirit Breaker? Well, it's still something he wants to go for, so he's gonna finish that in 200 gold. And also the Bloodseeker, even though he died in the last fight, but he was still witnessing, I think, one or two of these kills, then he died. But he got the Rupture out, he got the Blood Rite of both that hit and stoned Lemon Dog, so it was a good thing he did. He needs a lot more stats, though. That's the biggest problem. Still, we have a Midas rolling. And maybe even
Smoke
two Midas.
They're going to drop a ward right on the high ground. They know that this is spotted out, but maybe they can still look for a fight. They're going to snowball forward onto the Winter Wyvern. He's going to fly over the ice shards, and now fissured off. They can't chase for his kill. Witch's Curse onto Steph Style with the burst damage onto this Tusk. He's going to go down to start things off, and Eris Loco, they'll look for the Nether Strike, but they'll cancel that through with enough damage to kill off the Spirit Breaker, and that's also killing a triple for this Viper. So much value from the Nether Toxin, and oh, that was...
Jesus.
Yeah, that was so close.
That but Lestrak, he just picked up his Bloodstone. That's really good for Lemon Ducks.
Yep, the Lestrak, the first thing you do with the Bloodstone is losing charges, so that's of course not the start you want to go with that item. So that also means we have a tier 1 tower push, but not for long. I don't think that goes on very long, because they will make sure that this is going to be stopped with the lightning spam by the Lestrak. That's not going to happen there. It's just clearly harassing a bit with the Spike Carapace. That's all about it. But it was the first really good looking fight for Lemon Ducks besides little skirmishes.
Yeah. You have the Sanjinyasha and the Midas still coming up for Yellow Sub and the Spirit Breaker and Bloodseeker respectively, but they're starting to crawl their way back into this game, and a little bit more than crawl. They've taken what once was above a 5,000 net worth lead for Yellow Sub down to 2,500 into Yellow Sub's favor, and similar in the experience graph. They're starting to turn some of these engagements, and they need to. If they kept on the same pace and Yellow Sub were able to just farm up and get those big items, things look really bad, but Lemon Dogs have made this game interesting again.
Absolutely. I mean, these engagements, they were just, the positioning was just much better. The Winter's Curse happened with any crazy follow-ups right there. The Plot Ride also didn't do much damage, even though they were all sitting in it, but it was just too late. Like, everybody was dead by the time they were silenced or damaged by the Plot Ride. And the Lestrak was suddenly in the front lines where the enemy was like, okay, no problem. We get you. Like, especially the Viper there did so much damage. And the positioning was also nice, of course, for AoE healing, like the mech. Everybody just got a piece of the cake there. So it was just a horrible positioning for Yellow Submarine, and they had to pay for it. There's another pause again by Miroshka. Don't tell me it's again the Lashrax internet. Hashtag DC, hashtag DDoS, whatever.
Hashtag this isn't fun. I came here to watch Dota, not look at a pause screen. Tier 1 tower in mid is going to fall down to the Viper, and even though he doesn't get the last hit, that's still pretty nice for Lemon Dogs. I have no idea what we're going to do if this continues for Yellow Sub, but I don't know. We're stuck.
Well, ping-wise, it looks fine. You're actually the worst. Besides the Chinese cast, so you're the worst.
Obviously, I'm not surprised America. At all.
America-Luxembourg is definitely not a good connection.
Yeah, I play on Lux every once in a while, but yeah, sometimes you just get a bad ping. 165 is completely playable. It must be packet loss for the Lesh, even though we can't actually see that.
Tell that to a pro player. Like seriously, like if you play on the closest server to you, then you're totally happy about the 10 to maximum 30 MS. Everything else you notice.
You spoiled people. Like,
yeah, spoiled people.
On the US servers, I get like 90. Yeah. And that's pretty good. I don't know. We'll just get into this game. We're on pause. We'll resume.
I will not look down on a third world country like the United States of America. Like, oh, yeah.
Shots fired. But then the Nyx gonna go down bottom. Gonna spot eyes on the Bloodseeker. He's gonna walk around the corner. The Impel's gonna miss. Snowball's going to go under tower, but it's also not going to proc. And the Bloodseeker's just too fast, even with nobody particularly low. They'll turn for a rupture onto Steph Style with no Snowball. There's no hope of survival. He'll just run to his own death. He'll get mecked up by the Viper. And the turnaround with the Zeus will kill off the Lesh and the Bloodseeker. Still a good trade for Lemon Dogs. And it's not over yet as they start walking down the Spirit Breaker. The mass amount of slows from the Viper. Ooh, that was really awkward coming out from Yellow Sub. They did not expect Lemon Ducks to be there in full force.
Yep. I mean, they sort of knew there is a gank, but not the entire team, and also Steph Style. Steph Style knew he's gonna be focused down that Yellow Submarine. They follow that blood trail that comes from the Rupture. Usually you're like, oh my god, look at him, he's so noob, he runs around with Rupture, but his life throwing away with the Rupture and still moving, he brought them so far out that suddenly Lemon Ducks can actually turn around on this one. Oh. Winter Vibrant in the mid, spotted out by Krilly. All he needs is someone to come in, and there we go. He has no mana, nothing to actually do anything against this. So another easy kill for Lemon Dogs here on that Winter Vibrant.
And suddenly, Zeus has his Bloodstone. He's going to be sitting on a similar amount of total farm from the Lestrak. He is down in Ogre Club, but on the same side of the coin, the Lestrak is at 4 Bloodstone charges, half of what the Zeus is sitting on. And the big difference, the Lemon Dog supports are starting to pick up a lot of momentum. You have a Midas 4 staff on this Rubick at 21 minutes into the game. Incredible amount of farm for Eris Loco. He's found so much space.
Definitely. So 20 and 16. I think with the last fight, we have pretty much equalized this game. When it comes to net worth, yes, we do. So it's even heading towards a nice little cushion for Lemon Dogs. It's not the end of the game, and hell no, it's not a complete turnaround, but it's an equalizer. This game is just as open as it was pretty much at zero on the timer. Only difference, of course, and I emphasize it again, we have two Midases rolling now on Yellow Submarine, and that is going to be something Lemon Dog, they have to stop this, which means the pressure they had now, it has to continue. In the mid, Krilly, there is. Well, he's testing with the creeps and everything at the moment. What's going on? If there is a sentry, a drive-by cow is just coming randomly. He wants to get into that bottom lane. There's actually no gank whatsoever following up. But then, I think... No, I thought like Kant is actually killing the last creep and he's stuck in the trees around Roshan. Then you would have said, you Kant. I mean, you. My player. Kant. I love this name. And bullshit is
lagging.
Inside
the dire woods.
Bullshit lagging.
I don't know. We'll just leave it at that. We have a Vendetta Nyx stalking the Lashrak, and this Nyx Assassin sitting on a Yule Scepter. A really big item for Nyx. Allows him to set up his stun reliably, and this Lashrak might end up going down. He'll need a little bit more follow-up, but I think he can delay enough time to where Viper can come in. He has the Aghanim Scepter as well. The items are rolling for Lemon Dogs, and if Lash doesn't get appropriate backup to the Chuchu Tower, things get very interesting. I don't think Nyx will pull the trigger yet.
Yep, the Yellow Submarine is just not getting that dive through here. That's just not happening. At the moment, both of them, like Lashrak as well as the Bloodseeker, they're struggling with ping, Nidos, whatever the reason is. I don't even care, because I just want to see Dota. But the fact is, both cores having internet issues and not being able to play properly, that's of course bad news for a team anyway.
And it gets you into a really bad mindset too. Yep. Yellow Sub are going to be feeling really bad after those last two fights. Even if they wouldn't have gone differently, if they were playing on perfect ping, they'll feel like they would have gone better if they were able to play to their fullest potential. So, yeah, Yellow Sub are going to be pretty disheartened after the last couple minutes of this game.
Absolutely. Still, with the Midas, well, is there actually something on the courier or anything? This is, well, So, we're going to have the Spirit Breaker going for BKB. The Midas starts to pay off, getting him here and there some gold. By the way, like what we didn't even mention, or I was just about to mention before he had to pause, like the Lashrak seen by Krilly. I mean, at the moment, he can't see him. It's nighttime, he's behind the trees, but if the Lashrak moves a bit south and Krilly stays here, then this is enough range. Like, Krilly's vision goes till here, so Barash might soon find himself in a very awkward position. This would be the Viper potentially rotating in, even though that would be too obvious. Because, yeah, there is still a creep wave. If Viper suddenly starts ignoring creep and moves towards the enemy side, then that would be kind of obvious that there is a gank incoming.
Let's take a look at how long this Nyx Assassin can delay for the Viper to come in. Yes, 2.5 seconds from the Yule Cyclone, 2.77 from the Impale, theoretically if it's chained perfectly. And then Spike Carapace should stun the Lashrak if he tries to turn and fight the Nyx Assassin by himself. I'm not sure if that's going to happen, but I think in that time, Viper could come through. There is a sentry on the ground as well, down towards the south for the Dire's side, and I don't think the Nyx Assassin is going to go because of the potential for TP support. The Earthshaker doesn't have one, but I don't think that the Radiant know that, and Winter Wyverns is on cooldown. So even though the Nyx might make that call not to go, things would be interesting if he does decide to pull the trigger. He's going to walk around the corner, and Lashrak going to walk up towards the north. If Lashrak stays to farm these camps, then things could get interesting. The camp was blocked, and Brash should know something's wrong. Zeus Ultimate going to be committed. They're going to open up with a little bit of damage into Brash, but the Impale misses, and that's all she wrote. Nyx Assassin's going to hold on to that Yule Scepter, and up in top, they blow up the Bloodseeker.
Yep, this was Bloodseeker plus... Like, I think the suits, of course, contributing with the ultimate.
Yule Scepter, Dire Woods. Impale going to be nicely timed, but no follow-up.
Nope, that's not at the moment happening. I think Lemon Dogs, they just want to get that top tower. And yes, they kind of giving up. At the same time, of course, we also had, I think, yeah, the Spirit Breaker, Getrox, getting that tower. That's, of course, nice for his gold, because the next step for him will be the Mithril Hammer. And that's, like, still 1,000 gold away. Well, actually, it's not that far, because Midas is already off cooldown. The problem is now, Viper still with a double damage up. It's a relatively fresh one, half duration left. They can go even for the tier 2 tower, pushing a lot of damage in there. And Yellow Submarine, they took a beating in all the previous fights right now, ever since like minute 12, 13, 14, something around that mark, and yeah, it seems like they also dropped this tier 2 tower. Instead, Gedrox will push a tiny bit, but that's of course not the good one. Roshan is also not an option, because that would be just too high of a risk.
Yeah, it's not really going to be a trade at all for Yellow's sub, and looks like Lemondog should just be able to take it, especially with Viper being sustained by the stolen Blood Rage of the Rubick. With that Blood Rage, Viper is doing so much damage to this tower, and it's just going to be given up. Can Yellow Sub get anything substantial on the other side of the map? They'll place down a ward inside the Dire Woods. It's pretty good. And they farm up a Blink Dagger for the Earthshaker. Now, that's a big deal.
Absolutely. In the mid, well, the Leshrac is trying to go for something, but it's not going to be a tower. That's going to be a deny. Nicely, Cliff used at 11 HP off the tower. So that's going to be Tower Knight right there. After the TP came in, and I think they're ready to just push for the tier 2 tower. Lemon Dogs, as I said, they have a half-life on this game. They cannot wait till like minute 50, 60 or upwards, because then it's gonna get worse and worse for them in a late game scenario. Instead, they just scout out Roshan. Gatrox is still doing something around there, but he's coming back. There's also still nice vision around, to be honest, like, but at the moment the Zeus is not using his vault. He's just checking if there's some warding here, some warding there. Maybe he's gonna use this one. I don't know. But the fact is, he's checking. He's just checking if there are sentry wards.
They're gonna break the silence with a smoke gank. They'll have Blood Rage on the Earthshaker. This Echo Slam could hurt, and hurt a lot if they find people clumped. And we're paused. How fun! I love pauses. They're the best.
Okay, I was just about to write something, but let's just say we leave it at this. They're still smoked, and let's see if we go here directly into a fight here. Sentry Ward being scouted out.
Charge into the back lines. He's going in alone. The Spirit Brick is trying to focus down the Zeus, but he's going to get lifted up. They'll put the Rapture onto the Viper. He's going to stand his ground, trying to heal up through this. They'll put him in the snowball, caught up by the Fissure. We'll catch out three. Winter's Curse onto the Viper. Viper going to go down, but they've already lost the Spirit Breaker and the Earthshaker. Cold Embrace will buy Winter Wyvern a little bit of time as Zeus blows up the Lishrak, and now the Winter Wyvern's stun over in the sidelines. Is this going to be a 1-for-4 trade? They get the Viper, but they trade so dearly for it.
Yeah, a Viper for 4, that's not the way you want it. Like, the Platseeker never even got the chance to, like, go into that fight and right-click someone. He just doesn't have, at this point, enough HP pool, and yeah, he just can't stand this fight. Rubick actually stole one of the nicest abilities if you want to keep on pushing Cold Embrace. That is a level 4 ability right now. You can pretty much heal up everybody to full HP with this one. The cooldown on it is also ridiculously low. So I'd say this is a guaranteed tier 2, even though they have a fast respawn time. We're only 25 minutes in, so a charge could come out. The second he's going for it, and yes, the charge is on the Zeus. There's a nice blood trade, but he's blinking out. Nobody's getting silenced. There is a Rupture. You're going to use it on Aeris Loco. Is it actually get stolen or something? No, at the moment he's not going to use it, but a beautiful Akkas time right here, holding Steph Style in position. That's 2 down right here. The Sigil might be the financial bonus, but this one is also not going to happen. So tier 2 tower stands. They get 2 nice kills. This is worth a lot, actually. This is 2.4k gold exchange right there for those two.
Yeah, even though the Rubick is a support, he's not farming like one. He's sitting on more gold than the Spearpicker.
Oh, Nautic. He just put the sentry ward down, but the first thing he sees is death. That was Death knocking on his door. Of course, the Zeus sticking around, dewarding the fresh ward there as well. So this is not just 100 gold down with the ward. This is also, of course, his life lost and more gold to Lemon Dogs. Thanks to that, Haestron and Vendetta were both of them so swift into the jungle that he just did not see this coming.
And a Bloodstone charge for the Zeus up to 13. The Zeus is really packing a punch. Although that's going to be somewhat mitigated by the BKB coming out from Yellow Sub's Bloodseeker. This game is still anybody's for the taking. If we take a look, the advantage that Lemon Dogs had is being pared down after those couple pickoffs for Yellow Sub, and it's so back and forth. This is very interesting. Echo Slam going to be up in 80 seconds. There's a window where Lemon Dogs could, in theory, go for this push or go for some aggressive moves in the enemy woods, and it looks like they're going to do the latter. As the lead out with the Vendetta Nyx Assassin, they'll spot eyes onto the Spirit Breaker, but it looks like Spirit Breaker knows what's up.
Yep, looks like it. They still want to go for the tier 2 tower. Like, at the moment, the Zeus is just dewarding. He has no problem spamming that ability simply because he has so much charges. He already mentioned it, 13. So he doesn't have to be afraid of mana whatsoever. Only in fights, he might actually run a bit low if he spams, for example, too much plus the ultimate. That's pretty much the deal at the moment. Nyx Assassin, he's getting scouted out by this ward and also the Sentry ward. I think it sees this one. Yes, there the Arctic Burn comes out and he is dewarding it. So 75 for Observer is down, and it's a good one. Observers are always on cooldown. I mean, they have a cooldown, so therefore it's always good to find them and destroy them ASAP.
Load right in mid, going to destroy the creep wave with a little bit of help from the Earthshaker. So Yellow Sub can theoretically hold their ground here, but taking the fight's going to be difficult until they can delay out for the second time. But that said, they're going to have it in 10 seconds, and the potential is there for a really threatening fight between Winter's Curse, Lashrak damage, and Echo Slam. If Lemon Dogs have a lapse in positioning, they could get caught out very heavily. And with the smoke, I like this move from Yellow Sub, but last time it didn't work out at all. So let's see if this time's any different.
I like what Gedrox is doing. He's taking that farm top, so that's easy going for him. He even used a charge here. So
you will scepter right behind now. The tower. They catch out the Bloodseeker. Mana Burn will be committed, but with a Cold Embrace, all that damage is for naught. Bloodseeker will be sustained.
It's more or less just buying time at the moment. Yellow Submarine is not in a position where they want to fight, only if Lemon Dogs really overcommit into a certain position. So Gedrox is getting the farm, which means he's so close to that BKB. Give him a tiny bit more. He's actually TPing back. He would be ready to charge. I think they saw this. It's still nighttime, but he was so close to the creep. They saw this, but oh, look at this. He will scepter into the stun, but BKB pop as well as the Glimmer Cape. This Blood Rite is also not going to connect to anyone. Is there a rupture? Anything? He has no vision, but look at the Viper charge. Therefore, there is the vision. They have to burst him down. The burst is real. The Sigil, however, is gonna make sure they're not gonna follow up on anything. However, Krilly is still there, playing forward, double playing by the Earthshaker. Nice little regeneration rune right there, but Kunt is not going for the Fissure. However, oh, look at Mirshka. Look at this. The TP out is real, but the Fissure is just stopping it. That's a guaranteed kill by the Zeus, doing all that damage. Now, but Zeus, is that really the right thing you want to do with the Winter's Curse, with the Nether Strike? Oh, he's getting even bashed forward directly into the stun of Bagage. Beautiful. Even the Echo Slam holding Stefstar here in position. He has no abilities at this point anymore. Gnostic helping himself just in the Cold Embrace and the charge drive-by on Lemon Dogs here at the moment. Last survivor pretty much in all of this is the Rubik. Susava is back because of all the charges. He's blinking forward, but I don't think he's going to find any residual potential victim of this fight.
That was a good fight for Yellow Sub, with the exception being Tusk being able to get in the backlines and kill off the Bloodseeker. That's going to give Lemon Dogs at least something in return. It'll make sure that fight isn't as bad as it could have been, but it's still pretty darn bad.
Lashrak is bad. It was really bad because did you see that when he popped the BKB, I think the first some seconds were completely wasted on that BKB. That was a fresh 10 second BKB. Bloodrite didn't hit anyone, he didn't get the rupture off, so he was running and chasing, and by the time he was actually fighting, the BKB was wearing off. So the BKB timing, I thought this is going to be a disastrous fight, but in the end, it was all good.
It works well for the team, yeah. In general, now that Lashrak is on the same Bloodstone charges as the Zeus, and with Lashrak's BKB now up, there's not much that Lemon Dogs can do about him, and Lashrak's BKB was very influential inside that fight. The Tusk was subdued by the Echo Slam. It wasn't the big team fight that Yellow Sub necessarily wanted at the start of that, but Barash really carried that forward, even though the Bloodseeker was a little bit behind. And they're still keeping a nice advantage when it comes to gold for their main cores. The net worth graph has been completely zeroed out again. We're back to a blank slate there, and a slight experience advantage for Yellow Sub. It's so back and forth. If history is any indicator, Lemon Dogs will win the next fight, not because of any actual statistics or anything, other than the fact that that's how they change
scouting. Krilly is scouting. He
There's
sees
a Sentry
them.
Ward over towards the left. They're going to go in, trying to catch out this Earthshaker. They're flung into the air, but with Winter's Curse turnaround, not going to be able to save Earthshaker's life, but they'll at least get Sephstal in trade. BKB popped by the Lesh, as well as by the Spiritbreaker and Bloodseeker, and by Yellow and Huge running at the enemy team. They'll look for the Viper, but now the BKB's worn off, and we're paused again.
Wiki. WKN. What? We...
I don't know.
What? What?
This is...
That doesn't... Like, by the way, this is not Russian. Like, he was just typing with a Russian keyboard. This does not make any sense. Like, this is just him writing Bloodseeker lagging like hell with Kirillic. Like, this is not even readable. Oh, well, either way. I don't know. We have to put a limit of pauses, obviously. I mean, I don't want to force them into fighting with lag whatsoever, but...
It's getting to that point.
Pingwise, he's fine. Like, Pingwise, he's totally fine. It's Miroshka. Wait. No, he has 257 MS. Yeah. Oh lord. Never mind that.
Oh lord, indeed.
He's not fine at all. Not even close.
In the game and in real life, it seems. Bloodseeker is currently ruptured. This is... It's a hard knock life for Bloodseeker. Eris Logo has a telekinesis. They could pull him back in and kill off the Bloodseeker very fast before he's able to heal up off of any kills or any creeps. Though his Drax BKB has since worn off, he's currently mid-cast of a Lightning Storm that should bounce towards the Viper and the rest of the team if they can catch vision on the other two, that is. I don't know who this is going to favor. I'm pretty sure that this is going to work well for Lemon Dogs with or without the Bloodseeker having good MS. I think the Bloodseeker's dead.
Yeah, just making a statement. I mean, I hate to say this. I really hate to say this, but we have to pause. We have to limit the pauses at some point. I mean, every time he was coming back, like after 3-4 minutes or something like that, but if you have that like 10 times, then we have additional half an hour on the normal game time just for waiting for the seed guy. I mean, guys, don't forget, like, also the viewers, like, you can be complain about your items and whatnot or DDoSing, it doesn't matter. This tournament is really like some pre-TI content. The main goal of this tournament is to have fun, is to give the non-TI teams a chance to actually play some real Dota instead of just sitting around scrimming and then watching TI till August, till the next season pretty much starts. So, yeah, that's the main focus. That's why I'm also not super strict on every single thing, but, well, still. We all want to enjoy some Dota and not the pause screen, and that's where we are heading. So, the next time, we're not gonna wait that long anymore.
Yeah. Well, last chance for yellow sub, at least when it comes to pauses. But in this fight, I think it's pretty much over. At least what I see happening next, Bloodseeker is going to get lifted up and killed off by the Viper. Although Viper is going to eat a Lightning Storm, that's going to be annoying for them. Jalem's here and has more than enough mana to nuke down these heroes. Now that the BKBs have worn off. During the BKB duration, there's not much they can do, but I can very easily see Lemon Dogs turning this one around, even though it is a 1v4. Or a 3v4. Excuse me, I can't count. It's okay.
Well, the BKBs are all down. That's the biggest problem. Like, all of them are completely down at this point. Or, yeah, they are. Like, all three of them. There's just nothing really happening with the BKBs anymore, which means Lemon Dogs, it's good, because the Zeus can really go for it, but he also has, like, everything on cooldown. Ultimate already used. Viper has still the ultimate on cooldown, even though he has Arcanum, so that makes it really fast one. The Bloodseeker, this might be a kill. We actually have Telekinesis as well as Fateball ready on the Bloodseeker, so they might say, like, you know what, lift him up. Then again, I think Glimmer Cape was just cast on him. I think they just casted the Glimmer Cape on him. So
is that what those particles are?
Yeah, the purple particles, that's Glimmer Cape.
That's Glimmer Cape by the Wyvern. It just got put on cooldown. So
that's the Glimmer Cape.
You know, that makes things a lot more interesting, because there is no raw detection coming out from the side of Lemon Dogs. They have a Thunderbolt that was cast a while ago, but
well, it was like the split second before the pause, actually. So
okay,
still have
so
some
they're
residual
gonna have
vision.
That Glimmer Cape doesn't matter.
Yeah.
That's pretty much the state of things.
He's working on it. Yeah, I know. He's working on it for like half an hour. No, it's not that bad. We're waiting for like 2-3 minutes by now, but pauses are frustrating.
Yes, they are.
They are. They absolutely are. But nothing we can do. Anyway, this is the last pause we have to go for. Otherwise, like we can offer them just like yesterday for Lemon Dogs when they had DDoS problems, that we go for stand and load, but load is always shit. Like, I have to say it with those nice words, because it's really, like, Valve's load options are just horrible. Like, it's the worst thing you can ever do, but it's something we can offer them.
Source 2 will fix it.
Are you sure?
Oh no, absolutely not. I think Source 2 is going to break more than it fixes at this point.
This is like one of the latest memes, right? Like you, like those believers, they always think like, hey, Source 2 will fix it, and in reality, nothing's going to get better in Source 2, except for custom games.
Yeah, at least in my experience, the Reborn client is pretty good, and I like what they've done with the lobbies, and I think that's going to help out, at least with reloads and what have you. All the work that they put into custom games will somewhat bleed over when it comes to the network side of things.
Yeah.
Oh no. This is not the right direction to be going.
Canis, help me. I'm a caster. Let me out of here.
I am also a caster. What do I do?
No, but seriously, I mean, I said it yesterday already with Mike, like, in Dota 1, World of Warcraft engine, like, Warcraft 3 engine, it was so easy, you know, you could just save a game and then start there, and yes, sometimes there were some bugs here and there, but I mean, the load option in Dota 2 is, like, the worst ever, like, there's just no excuse for anything. You don't have... Not even every 5 minutes is saved. The saves are, they feel kind of random. Then the creeps are gone, wards are gone, abilities are suddenly gone. You don't see the cooldowns anymore on abilities. Items are gone. BKBs lost all their charges. Neutrals don't respawn. All the creeps are anyway gone from the map and they just spawn at the next 30 second timer. Like, the list of load bugs are so, so long. And I have no idea how old Dota is by now exactly. But it's been a while and it never got fixed.
Well. Bloodseeker's still not back.
By the way,
he's working on it.
Yeah, he's working on it. By the way, it's the same stuff going on in Counter-Strike, by the way, except you have like LAN events and everything. It's like also tons of games are paused and ruined by DDoSing. This problem. Pretty much all the games that are with beddings are having the same problem. Like every time there's something at stake, you have these problems.
He's trying to reconnect right now. Yeah, at least they're keeping us in the loop, but this is unfortunate. Man, tip-tap typing.
Yeah.
That must be like...
Come on, entertain the people while I'm trying to be some admin here.
What's entertaining here? It's a pause screen. What do I do? I don't know. My jokes are lame. I can't do that.
Yeah, we have to work on that kind of
jokes.
We have to get you in clown school or something. For some stuff.
Entertainment during pauses. It's important.
Yes. But it's too bad we cannot use webcams here on the Razer stream, because otherwise you could do some moves, crazy stuff, I don't know, just in your bedroom, just going for some, I don't know, you can dance for us.
I'm not sure how I feel about that. I'm not putting on a webcam show. Let's stick with Dota, or at least as much as we can. We have
another
display.
Choice. I'm your boss, I tell you. If you dance, you have to dance.
Alright then.
There's in Hefla TV, there are no things like human rights and employer protection. It's like, it doesn't exist.
Oh. Hmm. Well.
So he's reconnecting right now, but does he actually reconnect right now? And they have to choose. Like, it's 5-on-4, reload with stand-in, but then, as I said, once you reload with stand-in, then you have to play it through, and if that goes haywire, then nothing else you can do. And the funny part is, it's the second one. Like, the first one that was DDoS, like, the Lashrak said, Barash, he fixed it, and then Miroshka started. Like, once he fixed it, then Miroshka started to do it. I don't know.
It's like whack-a-mole with DDoSers.
Yeah. They swap from player to player. And it's such a coincidence, you know? Like, Yellow Submarine winning against Lemon Dogs. Yesterday, Lemon Dogs, like, winning against LC, where there was a 80-20 ratio, and suddenly, like, ooh, you know, let's go DDoS, because that would be such a nice bet for all those people who were betting on London Conspiracy with the 80%, but those who had like this like off percentage bet, they were like, damn it, I'm gonna be so damn rich.
Okay, back in the game. His Bloodseeker could be with us at any time. Let's quickly run over what's happening. All three BKBs have been used. No. We'll talk about something useless.
You spoil something, you make me hot for Dota, and then it's not gonna happen, and then I'm gonna be super sad. I don't want to be sad.
Right. Okay. So to save you from disappointment, we're going to talk about something completely unrelated.
Tell me about it. Go.
Well, the problem is, I don't have anything that's going on that's not Dota over the last couple of days, since my sleep schedule has been catering to the Douyu Cup, so...
I don't know, then let's... Wait, no, let's... Seriously.
This is always the problem. Whenever it's paused with us two, we just don't... I don't talk. I'm not a chatty person. The chat wants us to dance. I mean, I can dance all I want, but you can't have a webcam on it, so I'll do a little dance here in my chair. It's happening. Doing a little jig.
Give me pizza.
Give me pizza. I'd love to. I mean, if you lived across the street, I'd frisbee throw it, like, out my window. Sing you a lullaby. There is quite a lot of delay on stream, but... I don't know. Go to sleep, little chat. Don't you ever worry about those damn DDoSers. Just...
You're actually
just
singing?
Quiet.
That's cool.
Not really. That wasn't even singing. That was just a... I can't even come up with a lullaby about DDoSers. It's not working for me. The creative juices aren't flowing. It's all been stopped.
Is there no info how loading works? No. Like, I always get random minutes.
Oh, very well. We're ready to go.
Yeah. No. Let's just go. I don't really care. We have to do this.
There's going to be the lift up. There is the cold brace on the Bloodseeker. That's going to help out him a lot, even though he's not with us. They're going to be micro-missed. They go over to the sidelines onto Jollum, trying to focus him down. They're taking a lot of damage, but with 17%, they'll kill off the Zeus. And the Viper is still standing strong. They're chasing forward. Eris Loco does have enough damage with some help from the Viper. It's a full five-man wipe. But keep in mind, that was Yellow Sub running without their Bloodseeker. And now we're going to minute 33. And from there on out, we'll try to reload into the game with a stand-in.
Yep, let's hope that it's fixing it, but that's the only chance they have. Like, and then with that stand-in, if he lags or something, then Yellow Submarine's only chance to like win this game is gonna be a 5-on-4. Sorry, there's nothing I can do from our side. May it be internet problems or DDoS, the fact is, like, there's no postponing, guys, which means the games have to be played through today or never. Pretty much. So tight schedule, especially because of the TI. So let's focus on this one. There was a long pause. LD pretty much came back into this fight, as well as the fight being in favor for LD. It was a 5-on-3 trade or so. We wait till minute 33:05, actually. Oh, Krilly is making all the theory. Krilly is a very smart guy, so I just trust him in like his little feeling.
You okay?
That was
well,
not
there we
33.
Go. That's 33.
Okay,
so how do I do this?
You create the lobby, you leave this game, then you go on load, and yeah, guys, we're gonna be back in, I don't know, hopefully just 2-3 minutes, so be right back, waiting screen for a tiny bit. So guys, we're back, we're reloaded, and this is gonna be horrible, 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 but yeah, no intro, no nothing. I'm gonna show you how horrible loads are, but these are the rules. We have to go for it. Let's see, 30 minutes, that's the save. The bottom fight did not happen.
And here we are.
Yeah.
I have no idea what we're going to do about the next bit of this game. I think we just play on.
Yeah, that's from 30. That's it.
That's it. There's nothing more to go.
No, Lemon Dogs know how it is because yesterday they were in trouble. Like, they had two players that got DDoSed, and we also made a load for them. Anyway, so guys, we are back in this game. We have to a bit orientate at this point. Lemon Dogs have a tiny advantage, I think. So, no, wait, like, where the crafts are obviously kind of screwed. So, 500 gold advantage, but like the last two fights, I think, oh no, the last fight that was in favor for Lemon Dogs is of course missing now. That's bad news for them. Good news for Yellow Submarine. Then again, of course, they have the problem that they have, of course, a stand-in on a core, very important player. So that's not the way you wanted.
Oh dear.
Yes.
Oh dear.
Yes, Burrow. Nice.
I don't know what to say. Can he use Vendetta?
I don't know. That's the bug that we also had yesterday on the Nyx Assassin. It didn't show any cooldowns, and he suddenly had Burrow without having the Arcanum Scepter. As I said, Volvo, you really done a great job with the loading ability.
Well, we're back into this game. We have a Solar Crest up for the Tusk, and it looks like Lemon Dogs want to go for a smoke. Vendetta is usable by the Nyx Assassin, and Quirly's in good faith, not going to skill up Burrow, not going to get that free Aghanim Scepter gifted him by Volvo. He'll walk up to the high ground. They have a sentry here that secures Nyx Assassin this rotation. He's going to Yule Scepter up the Winter Wyvern, drop him down, impale a little bit, missed time. They'll turn for Winter's Curse onto Quirly, silence him up. They will be able to bring down this Nyx Assassin with BKB's pop on everybody. They're going to jump forward with the Rupture onto the Viper. It's going to be a little bit difficult to take this fight. BKB's on all three of the major cores. This is going to be a big turnaround. The Viper's standing strong, but not standing for very long. They'll try to kill off any of these heroes, but Winter Wyvern will stop that dead in its tracks. They'll chase forward for Eros Loco. That's the fourth hero to hit the ground, even though they lose their Bloodseeker. And Jolin gets the Winter Wyvern. It's still a good fight for Yellow Sub. Can he cancel CP the Spoiler from Fog? And that's going to be Jolin down. Can he get Gidrox before going? It won't happen. Ultra kill for Barash. And suddenly, this game looks completely different.
Yep, it's a completely different game. All of a sudden, we have Lemon Dogs actually taking a heavy beating here. Mostly because like that chain stone, that chain disable on the Nyx Assassin, that was just so painful. He wanted to make that Yule Scepter set up into, of course, a stun by the Nyx Assassin. But the Winter's Curse, that is, of course, nice that he cast it on him right away. So it was also wasted for the fight. But there was just no follow-up. Lemon Dogs, they just didn't get fast enough into that fight. Therefore, it really didn't turn out the way they wanted it. So they take a beating, the game a slight turn towards Yellow Submarines, and well, we have to see where this one is going. It is not something they can follow up directly into Roshan because they were itself pretty low in all aspects, and well, they're already again up and alive. They look for Roshan because that's what they suspect at this point.
Zeus is going to walk around trying to get as many D-wards as possible. Not going to find it, and nobody's inside the Roche Pit. They'll successfully D-ward this Dire Observer, but even though Lemon Dogs aren't completely stomped out with that fight, and even though they're going to try for Roshan, this is very risky. Yellow Sub have no Echo Slam, but even without Echo Slam, their fight into the Roshan Pit is very good with the BKBs up again for the Spearpicker, Lesh, and Bloodseeker. Looks like Yellow Sub are grouping up for a smoke of their own, and I don't think this Rosh is falling fast enough, even with Solar Crest.
Yep, at the moment Roshan is really, really slow in hitting and everything, but, well, they have at least Krilly, like, sort of scouting for him. Is there a gem or anything? No, not really. We need sentries. Now he sees Notzig. There's a sentry ward, making sure that the Nyx Assassin doesn't come from behind, but there's the opening now. Stun him right away, but he's also charged with the BKB. This is horrible. Notzig, however, going down. There's no Winter's Curse for this fight. Let it go on the bar. Nice little disable. He's TPing out. He has a long BKB, so that's no problem. Looking on the other side of this fight, Zeus was already battling that Bloodseeker. Now it's Sparsh actually trying to run away, having everything on, taking the creeps because he knows he's gonna die there. That mana burn is just so much damage. They take two down here. The rest is pretty much back to the fountain. Roshan is easy for them to go now. It's on half HP anyway, and I think they're gonna finish this.
Yeah, this is a big turn of events for Lemon Dogs. That fight was so spread out by Yellow Submarine, and getting the Wyvern down at the beginning of the fight is close to the worst-case scenario for them. The Wyvern in that last exchange kept everybody alive for so long, and was really crucial in them taking that engagement. Now Viper has an Aegis, and now Lemon Dogs are going to take this fight and turn it back into their advantage. We're still in a very topsy-turvy game, even after the load.
Yeah, it's a full from back. I mean, like, first getting, like, a full team and wipe. Now they get two really nice kills. Plus, not to mention, all the BKB charges, of course, minus one on Yellow Submarine. And we had, well, Kant showing himself, but that four-step forward by the Rubik, that was not the way you planned it. But looking at the BKB charges right now, we have seven on the Leshrac, about the same on the Spirit Pick, exactly the same, and here we should even be one more down. No, actually one more up. I thought the Bloodseeker used it a tiny bit more, but that was just me, my bad memory of the last game. 8 seconds still left, so give it another 2-3 fights, and we are just looking at 5-second BKB, and that's good for Lemon Dogs. Every second down off that BKB is good news for them.
And another good news, they're getting close to a situation where they can start sieging for high ground. No tier 2 towers remain for them to take on the side of Yellow Submarine, but with an Aegis with a 10-second BKB up for the Viper, they're very sustained, and it looks like they want to find a fight. Stefcel's there, he has phase boots, wants to find initiation, he's going to bump right into the Winter Wyvern, trying to fly over the trees. The Winter Wyvern's going to buy herself a little bit of space, they'll get the impale inside the side, and now that Arctic Burn has worn off, Winter Wyvern is going to end up falling. It's only a matter of time, Walrus Punch will jam at home.
They accepted this as well, like, they lay a Lost Submarine, they knew he's gonna be completely out of position, no one bothered to go even in there, so that's an easy, nice and easy pickup for Yellow Submarine, and you can all, for Lemon Dogs, I mean, and you can also not forget that every time Lemon Dogs are somewhere, they're dewarding, so that's the good thing. Now, here in the mid, he's gonna spam, like, all the time, and all these sentry walls, this is tons of gold spent by Yellow Submarine, just to make sure that Krilly is not getting the right initiation, and, well, sentry ward popped. They find the other one, it's already being dewarded, and the slow siege begins here. Viper up quick to the Aegis, that's the right thing to do. He also has an Arcanum Scepter, so he can spam that ultimate, but nicely stolen here, of course, that golden praise. And whoa, look at this, Netherstrike, here on the Viper.
He's gonna try for it, but with the mischance coming out from the Solar Crest as well as the Glimmercade, Viper is gonna survive very easily too. And Cold Embrace is in the hands of the Rubik. Rubik can sustain them while they go for this higher ground push.
And
now
Viper
it is
back.
A full 5v5, but yeah, this is very scary.
The Winter Wyvern back into this fight, which means now Yellow Submarine, they are of course in a much better shape to actually defend this. Of course, Kant with the Fissures, they don't make it really easy. Like Fissure plus the Splinter Blast, that should just do the trick on the Creeper. If you see, barely anything is really surviving, so Lemon Dogs, they call it a day. They say like, okay, that's enough sieging for one day. We go and just farm a tiny bit, and we come back in a minute or two after we found another pickoff or another fight where we can capitalize on. That's pretty much their goal at this point, I think. And might not even be bad, because you lose a lot just sitting there at the tower, even if you have the Aegis. They still have 2 minutes time to use it.
Despite losing a handful of fights, Yellow Sub are still farming very well on their Leshrac as well as their Bloodseeker. The difference is when you look at the supports, but the supports have what they need too. Krilly caught out, can't cast that Spike Carapace, and he gets bashed. He'll be able to get Carapace before that bash, but a Fissure comes through, and that'll be the death of him. Spirit Breaker pops the BKB, a little bit unnecessarily, but it's down to 5 seconds anyway. It doesn't change the outcome of this game.
But we looked at it, it was 7 seconds, now he used it in the previous fight, and now he used it for that gank on Krilly. In retrospect, I guess it's cool now that you have like just a 5-second BKB on the Spirit Breaker. That makes it a lot easier. That's what I'm talking about the BKB charges. Steph style in the mid. He's hasted, but of course, not so sure if that's still the right thing to do, to go that aggressive. If there's a Winter's Curse on him, that should be easy kill, but Yellow Submarine, they're going back. Is that for a smoke or anything like that? Nope, we don't even have a smoke equipped on anyone.
Rubik is getting so much farm, and that's really the advantage coming out from Lemon Dogs, is in the pockets of this Rubik. He has 4 staff, Glimmer Cape, Arcanes, Point Booster, Hand of Midas, everything, and then some that a Rubik would want at this point in the game. And, well, let's see. Aghanim Scepter in this match in particular is okay, but not that great. An Aghanim Scepter upgraded Spirit Breaker ulti is good, but I think the biggest pull to that item for the Rubik would be that he's able to chain throw spells out. This might be a Bloodstone on Rubik instead.
I mean, what does a Ganem Scepter do here? I mean, like, as in, not the lower cooldown and whatnot improvement. Obviously, the ultimate. Like, we have improved Echo Slam, yes.
Echo Slam ultimate upgrade is terrible. Gives you, at max, a little bit of
the
extra
Nether
damage,
Strike
maybe 200.
Is a bit AoE, more damage. Okay, yeah.
More damage from Pulse Nova, but if he gets it, it's entirely
for
the cooldown decrease. But there's the Echo onto Eris Loco. The follow-up is going to come through with the Spirit Breaker, popping his BKB. But he's not going to find the initiation they want because of the Glimmer Cape. They'll jump onto Steph's Tile. They'll have Vision of the Rubick. He'll get Winter's Curse back, but the follow-up damage just isn't coming through. The Bloodseeker wants to join this fray, but he has the Solar Crest on him. He's hardly doing any damage, and they're gonna land an impale onto this Lushrak. Viper, even though Ruptured, can just stand still and fight here. He's gonna get stunned. Nice put out coming out from Barash, but with the Cold Embrace stolen by the Rubick, the Viper is still at a huge amount of HP, and now the Rupture's worn off. They're just gonna run them down. Impale is not gonna connect onto the Bloodseeker nor the Winter Wyvern, but with the Yule Scepter out, Valak is going to be dropped low, charged away by the Spirit Breaker, run away by the Bloodseeker, and my goodness, these heroes are super fast. TP out by the Earthshaker. Is that gonna save his life? It will. Impale was a little too late.
How did they survive this? Like, this
was
amazing.
Was a race car.
Like, I mean, besides, of course, the fissure that ended this fight, and of course, that also that nice little drive-by stun on three heroes with the charge of Mr. Barastrum. Besides that, still, like, the fight fall from back, and the focus of Lamandox just not good enough, I think. Like, Getrox was in range even for the Viper to attack, but they choose to go for other targets. And I think he should have died there, and him being dead, that would have, for example, I don't know, make a difference then at the end of the fight. However, it's... Was this a 1-1 trade? If I counted right? Yeah. It was really just 1-1. It looked like so much more, but now not going through.
It's ridiculous. They try to focus so much onto this Viper, and the Viper is so tanky. He's sitting on about 2,000 base HP with Corrosive Skin to back him up, as well as 24 armor. And whenever you have the Rubick there, he's stolen Cold Embrace so many times this game. And it is actually going to be the Aghanim Scepter for the Rubick. And I like this pickup, mostly because there's just so many spells that he can get his hands on such engagements. They'll catch Vision of the Earthshaker onto the High Ground, charge forward, Winter's Curse onto Krilly with another strike to follow up. They'll blow up that poor Nyx.
Ouch, that one really hurt. That was Netherstrike as well as Lightning plus the Split Earth directly cast on him. Ridiculous amount of damage he's got there. And first I was also saying, like, okay, yeah, you got Vision on that Earthshaker, but the entire team was just not there. The Viper was far away, the Rubick was not there, and not to mention, like, the Zeus, like, that much in the front lines. I don't think that would have been really, like, a good idea. So that was a strange fight to take, and Krilly has to pretty much be the scapegoat for all of this, and he's the one who has to pay the price.
Also a little bit strange, Earthshaker backs off for a second pair of boots. I didn't even realize that, I thought he just stuck with the arcanes, but he'll purchase up Tranquils. It's not a terrible choice coming in from the Earthshaker, and it's very fashionable to have both of your feet covered, but...
But it's one is blue, one is green, that's like not the latest fashion, but latest fashion is of course getting kills like this on Getrox. He has cooldown on his... Never mind, he doesn't, it's already back, but it's still not enough. He has a charge out, but it's nothing they can actually do to interrupt. There's a Rupture on the Viper going away from the plot drive. BKB also being used now. Stun is kicking in. This is not an Abyssal, this is a normal Basher, and they really go for it. Lashrak also going ham. Nice Echo Slam onto, while the Viper is dying somewhere in the back lines, not really doing anything. Kunt is trying to get the Wrath here off the Zeus, but also surviving on low HP again. Now they are all being so pushed forward. Getrox gets the mini interrupt, but still the bash out. That Snowball trying to go for the Bloodseeker, but both of them are dying. The Zeus still trying to run. Oh, look at this again. Three of them down, and Getrox just not dying. How is he just not dying? There's the charge around. Zeus has 1 second, and is enough. Yes, he's gonna get it. Kunt. That last hit, it's not enough. He's gonna get that double kill right here. Is there anyone to kill him? That urn charge, not getting him down. Okay. I have no idea how they just got the last three kills right there, but it just happened.
Yeah, the Zeus makes that trade a lot better for Lemon Dogs, but it's still very good for Yellow Sub, since the Lushrak collects huge inside that exchange. Up to 11 Bloodstone charges, he has his Octarine Core completed, and now up to 3,200 gold on top of all of that. Lemon Dogs, for the first time in a while, they end up getting spread out inside these fights, and it's a lot easier for Yellow Sub to focus them down. They weren't able to get that Spirit Breaker kill. The charge was successful, and then on the sidelines, he was able to earn up and get back to a reasonable amount of HP to where he could rejoin the engagement. And the Spirit Breaker, although he does go down to the Zeus at the end of all of that, draws the Zeus attention for so long that everybody else gets picked off. So it works out nicely for Yellow Sub.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, the biggest problem at this point is that the Viper always eats the Rupture, which means the Viper suddenly becomes a tower. It's more or less really, the Viper stands there, is tanky as hell, but, like, he's really a tower with yeah, like similar qualities. It's like a turn, just standing there trying to find someone, but he's getting kind of, whenever you get low HP, you just get out of the range of the Viper, and he's just not moving because he has that Rupture on it, and he also eats all the other spells that are so easy to set up. And also the Earthshaker at the moment is playing such an important role for Yellow Submarines. Can't, however, oh my god, Jolem getting stunned. I think he's completely stunned in here. Yeah, he can't really go. Oshiba's interrupting Kant's Blink Dagger, but is there any follow-up? There is already... I mean, there's the invisibility rune, but he's charged, and that charge is gonna be interrupted. It's not going through, and a nice standoff starts here. Roshan is gonna be back in like less than a minute. This is, what, 50 seconds, and that's gonna be our next fight, Grandis.
Yeah, with the Blink Dagger on the Winter Wyvern, with the ultimates back up and running for everybody, this could get very interesting. Charge forward, they won't be able to cancel it. BKB's popped, and he's gonna go straight onto Stepsout. Vision from long range will come forward, blink into the Enchanted Totem. Stepsout gets a lucky miss from the Earthshaker, but not a lucky miss from the Spearbringer. He'll even bash him for good measure, currently cut out in the sidelines. He'll also go down, and the Viper's standing alone against so many heroes. This Basher on the Bloodseeker's really been turning so many of these fights, and now Yellow Sub, they have a free Roshan, or they can maybe go for some objectives. They'll charge over the top. They know that Roshan is up, and things are looking really good for Yellow Sub now.
Absolutely. I mean, like, did you just see the perfect chaining of stuns? I mean, The fight for, like, the fight to get the Tusk down alone, that took 6-7 seconds. He was relatively tanky, but he did not have the single split second time to cast, for example, Snowball on anyone. It's ridiculous. Like, they really did it perfectly. The Spirit Breaker, Nether Strike, then Kant coming in, that was Fisher, the Enchant Totem, etc., etc. It was just ridiculous how perfectly stunned that was by Yellow Submarine. And then, of course, they took one out. They took Krilly out, who was somewhere in the back lines, but instantly Winter's Curse. And again, the same situation on the Viper, like, disarmed as well as Rupture on him, so he was more or less a tower without the whole tower shooting. So that's pretty much the summary of the last fight, and that's something, yeah, Lemon Dogs, they have to overcome this. Like, the Viper needs a bigger impact, and they need to somehow interrupt this chain of CC.
You said a couple minutes ago, in fact, now after all the pauses, it might even have been a half an hour ago, that Lemon Dogs were sitting on a half-life this game, and I think it's starting to double over right about now. The Bloodseeker is sitting on a Demon Edge on top of his Skullbasher. I'm a little bit surprised he doesn't go for the completed Abyssal Blade, even though there is evasion on the Tusk coming out from the Solar Crest, but now that evasion means nothing, and this Bloodseeker is going to be hitting so hard. I don't think that Lemon Dogs have a very good chance unless they can find the dream fights for them. That involves getting onto the back lines and killing off these supports, and that's very difficult. Winter Wyvern's holding onto a gem, has Blink, has Glimmer Cape, and is naturally pretty mobile, and the Earthshaker, too, is not the easiest of kills. Lemon Dogs have lost all semblance of momentum.
This D-warning here at the moment going on, but they have vision on the next assassin. Again, the initiation, BKB on while he's charging already. This time the Rupture on the Seuss, being stunned, chain stunned here in the back lines. He's definitely going down. The question is what else is happening here. Tusk gets the Winter's Curse, but they still try to fight Krilly. Get the hell out of this fight here, but the other BKB are also popping the Viper again. This arm can't really do anything, and now the Rubik under attack by the Bloodseeker. He gets for now at least away, but also Stepstyle now under attack, and they just blink forward and should just finish him off. They have perfect vision on him. In the back lines, the Rubik, he actually managed to get out, but they lose two, and they might even lose the third one, because Krilly is still somewhere around here, and by the time he lands from that Yule Scepter, he is going down. Lemon Dogs just losing here, right and left here at this point. Yellow Submarines with a stand-in now are not losing anything in their potential.
Yeah, Lemon Dogs cannot stand and fight these heroes anymore. The advantage for Yellow Sub is starting to become insurmountable. The biggest issue for them is that a lot of their gold is tied up in this Rubik, and it's good to have a farmed Rubik, don't get me wrong, but they need more items on this Viper and on this Zeus before they can be super relevant. Zeus's damage output is really not doing enough, and nope, BKB popped by the Spirit Breaker. It is a 5-second BKB after all, so we can afford to drop that, but even the Spirit Breaker, he has a Moon Shard, for God's sakes. This is a ridiculous amount of farm for Yellow Sub, and, well, Lemon Dogs are on the ropes, and this game is close to over. Even though the advantage isn't that huge when it comes to the raw metrics, what this translates into in the team fights means a lot more for Yellow Sub.
The Moon Shard as a next step here on this, like, as an item, is actually very interesting, because usually you expect, okay, he sells to earn, even though it's pretty nice to interrupt all the Blink Daggers right now when you're chasing. Also selling the Midas, then going for another item or something, that would have been an option. But yeah, Moonshard right now, why not? You can keep it, now sell an item, replace it, or like use the Moonshard and replace it there and just keep the Midas rolling and everything. It's cool because you save the Midas uptime as well as having that nice little utility item earned, which also does a lot of healing for them at this point, believe it or not. So yeah, 50 minutes earned is still a up-to-date thing. Krilly trying to scout now, trying to find something. They need good fights at this point, Lemon Dogs.
Nyx Assassin can't go into enemy lines safely. The gem's currently sitting on the Spirit Breaker, and things are looking very hard for Lemon Dogs. Finding these good fights relies on Yellow Sub splitting up and getting caught out one by one. Blink in mid lane. The Impale's going to be dodged by the BKB, now charged forward by the Spirit Breakers. The backline fight is breaking out. Snowball's going to dodge a lot of what that Echo Slam did, but now that the Bloodseeker smokes down the Viper, they don't have much chance to survive with that said Viper. They'll turn around, and the Zeus's damage is actually enough. Viper doesn't get the kill or enough healing from that kill, so that's going to mean that they can turn around, look for this Lestrak kill. They'll lose the Aegis. Yellow Sub are starting to lose some ground. Krilly's getting chased down. The Arctic Burn will be enough to secure that, but my goodness, Jalem is being unanswered. Cold Embrace is all around, going to save both of his teams. Oh, he gets a lucky miss on the Spirit Breaker. He's going to survive as he charges away. Back in the main fight proper, Barish is still fighting to the best of his ability against all of these heroes. Looks for the Splitter, catches out Krilly. Will find himself a wicked 6 free, 20 Bloodstone charges. And Barash, even though he can't go for any more, the Bloodseeker, the Spirit Breaker.
Blink forward. There we go. Oh, but BKB! The BKB's coming out from the Lashrak. Oh, God.
With Doctoring Core, it's such a low cooldown, and with that, it's going to be a 3-for-3 trade.
Wow, that was so close, actually, that Yellow Submarine loses all 5 here, because that Lashrak, with the help of Rubick, would have died. Getrox, again, like, I don't know how many times he survives, like, below 100 HP, but this was another time, uses the Midas and runs back home. That was also so close, that charge out, very last second. If Krilly had here Spike Carapace, would have been an easy kill. Unfortunately, he had to use Heal Scepter right after, which was the perfect setup for the Lashrak to just heal... just go for the split earth. That might have been the fight Lemon Dogs needed. And this was, mind you, this was with the Aegis on Yellow Submarine, so this game is far from over. This was a pretty much a 6-on-5 fight.
Even though it's far from over, a big issue in that last engagement was that Yellow Sub, the Lestrak gets the kill into the Viper. Under normal circumstances, just securing the kill is usually enough, but Bloodseeker was so low he needed that heal to continue fighting. Bloodseeker has gone for Sanjinash and BKB as far as his defensive items are concerned, but at this point, that's not enough, unless he can get a kill for the first Blood Rage shield to keep himself sustained. If Bloodseeker gets that heal, I see that going a lot worse for Lemon Dogs, but props to Jalem, especially his positioning in that last fight, also bailing them out in a huge way. If it weren't for the Zeus, killing off that Bloodseeker wouldn't have been possible, but now, bottom lane, going to blink forward, Ice Shard, Snowball, gonna be dodged by the BKB. They'll get the Walrus Punch, but Barash has a heart. This guy is almost at 4k HP. Killing him off is gonna be really hard. Zeus's passive is gonna go to work. Now the BKB is over, but with the Winter's Curse, Krilly's gonna get two-shot near enough by the Bloodseeker. Now Jalem is going to eat the Rupture. They have a Fissure long range to cancel that. Jalem will get glimmered up, and that'll buy him a little bit more space to start spamming out his Thunderbolts again. Snowball into the sidelines, gonna stun up Barash, but the Lestrak is still sitting on more than enough mana to keep on fighting. He's getting killed so much between his ultimate ticking as well as the Cold Embrace. Zeus is going to keep on Thunderbolting him down. Blink and Echo Slam, they'll kill off the Lash, but maybe at the cost of a couple more. The stun onto the Viper, they get a lucky bash. The damage isn't quite enough, however, the Bloodseeker isn't close by, but now that he's going to join the fray, this Viper could very easily go down. The Bloodseeker's hanging on the sidelines, waiting for the Lash to join the fray again. After respawning from his Bloodstone, they're going to get the slow onto Jalem, get the support Earth to connect as well. Aeris Loco stuck inside the trees. Jalem, man-fighting to the best of his ability, but now that the Bloodseeker comes in with a couple of bashes, there's not much hope for Jalem. Gemetrucite's down on the ground, but Glimmer Cape is going to wear off anyway, so that's not going to be super relevant. Cold Embrace going to land on the Winter Wyvern, looking for the Split Earth, not going to connect. Zeus blinks out to safety, looking for the TP. First hit bash is going to happen.
MVP, oh!
It's going to proc! He gets him! Jalem forced a Bloodstone suicide.
Oh, Jesus. That is so, so unfortunate. I mean, come on. First hit bash. Jesus Christ. What a fight.
Super long fight.
What a
guys.
Long drawn fight. This was, it even felt like a fight with the Aegis because the Lashrak was coming back into the fight by BUTs because he had like so many Bloodstone charges that he was out for 10 seconds or so. It was just horrible. Like, the biggest problem about this fight was that, like, it took Lemon Dogs really a long time to get reinforcements and everything in. Otherwise, it looked really good. Problem is the Viper couldn't finish off certain targets. Like, so many Glimmer Capes and Cold Embraces and whatnot. Well, what is that? Staff Style? Okay, that one is not really working. He's getting stunned to death. And the Bloodseeker is just saying, like, okay, I just found a bigger creep. Like, nothing happened. So, shaking it off. Really cool style. Krilly is the next one to go for. I'm not so sure that's a good idea. Because at this point, the Lashrak are also so tanky. That, how long did they need to kill the Lashrak in the first place? That was this ridiculous.
Rack has a hood now. The biggest issue for the Lash is that he doesn't have that much mana to speak of, but okay, I don't think we can pause for this. I think we just have to go. But yeah, this Lash is so darn tanky. Do they have a solar crest on anybody? No. Yeah, but if they did, this Lashrak would be damn near unkillable. He's sitting on almost 4k HP with 41% physical resist and 47% magic resist. It's super, super hard. Yeah, and as long as the Bloodseeker has his BKB up, they can't really fight. No, over in the sidelines, they'll catch with the Earthshaker. This is a good pickoff, but Glimmer Cape's gonna delay a little while longer. They'll have to right-click into death, and that takes a while if you're a Zeus.
Yep. And yeah, we just can't wait anymore. Like, the entire schedule, everything, and I mean, I'm already, like, very, very relaxed with the rules and everything because it's a fun tournament before the TI. And still, like, that is just too much. If we now have disconnects and whatnot, then I don't know, where do we go? Like, 2 hours break. Not gonna happen, guys. Anyway, 55 minutes into the whole thing, Yellow Submarine still have a very, very formidable lead when it comes to net worth. They just found an Earthshaker, which was a bit out of position because he was about to ward there. And yeah, talking again about the half-life of this game, that's the biggest problem. Like, they need to push soon Lemon Dogs or get Roshan, which is up, by the way. So that might be something. Then again, going into Roshan, taking a horrible fight in a very clutch spot because you have the Lashrak, for example. His AoE in this region is just getting ridiculous. But there is some scouting. They have the Observer Ward. There's the Blink by Jolem. Does he deward it? If he does and shows himself, if he attacks it, then there is vision. Like, Krilly is not getting charged, 4 stuff down, gets a punch by Roshan. Sure, why not? And then they just go. That's the good thing about Zeus. You can really just destroy every single vision and ward you have by your enemy.
Yeah, these cores are starting to get capped out. Lashrak is sitting on enough gold to finish up his pipe, but he's not going to do that till he has pipe and buyback, and even just the hood is probably good enough for now. The Bloodseeker has one slot to replace, that's the Hand of Midas, but outside of that, he has all of the items that he'll want. And the Zeus also is getting really close to having his completed Scythe of Vice. It looks like he's going to buy out for this one and not wait for buyback. It might end up biting them, but he has 11 Bloodstone charges, so we'll be back up soon enough, even if he does go down.
The biggest problem is right now the Bloodseeker, because he's getting really fat. The next item he can replace is pretty much the Hand of Midas. Or he just goes for instant consume Moonshard, something like that. He has the stun as well as the True Strike, which means Viper for him is not a problem. Viper is gonna answer the whole thing pretty much by going for a Reaver, but a Reaver at the moment on a Viper does not really add so much HP. What that translates into one more hit by the Bloodseeker, pretty much. Maybe one and a half or two, but that's it. And so far he was locking onto that target. Rupture was mostly on the Viper, so I don't think like more HP, for example, on the Viper is gonna really do the trick. I was more looking forward maybe to, yeah, some protection by the team, even a Theora Flight or something, which is of course also bad news because you have the Lashrak around.
Yeah, it's really hard to itemize on the Viper this game. I don't think there are items that are going to make the Viper
we need more Lotus
against...
Orbs.
Fair enough.
Yesterday we had, what, 2 Lotus Orbs in a game?
Yeah, it could be really good. The issue is who's going to farm that. The Rubick, in theory, could get his hands onto a Lotus Orb, and he has enough gold almost to buy that straight up. In fact, I think he can. But yeah, the Viper just doesn't have enough slots to kill off everybody on the side of Yellow Sub. He's not, like, a Spectre, a Dusa, even a Bloodseeker. He's just not doing enough DPS, and that's a problem. He can't stay alive long enough in the fights for another Toxin Corrosive Skin to get value anymore, and he can't get a front-loaded burst damage. This is hard.
Oh, look
smoking
at that
me
smoke
out from Yellow Sub. Yeah,
they were expecting to have them in Roshan, but instead, oh, they find Krilly directly into the Gem Carrier. He's blinking out. BKB already used that as a nice start into this fight, but also Steph style. That's not really the right one. The Snowball is coming through. They focus here on Getrox, but man, he's really in trouble now. There's the Winter's Curse. Beautiful timing. Choke point, but this Fisher is, I think, more helping London Conspiracy than anyone else. They tried to turn around, but Zeus is going to die. No, is he actually going to die? Look at the healing by the Octarine Core. He's still somehow alive in the backlines. The Viper is really trying the best. They should focus on Getrox. Getrox is now going down, but the evasion, Jesus Christ. Now Echo Slam onto, is there a steal by the Rubick? Now we have it. There's the Echo Slam. Turn around. Nice little stun. The Viper still standing. He's trying to really do everything. Notzik still alive. He's not really getting him now. Finally, they're the Cold Embrace on Kant holding him a bit still, and Viper still trying to reach in a bit up, but no, there's the revenge, and it's only the Rubick left. Four stuff forward, trying to do something with the Regen on the Lashwreck. They should have enough mana to actually get him down, but look at it, Lightning forced on the other side, and he played so well, Eris Loco, but I don't think you can actually escape on this one.
Out of the frying pan, into the fire, and they'll be able to bring down Eris Loco, but my goodness, even though that turns out to be a 3-for-5 trade in favor of Yellow Sub, the amount of healing the Zeus got in that fight was absurd.
Yeah.
If you saw his HP bar, it was going faster than twice Fountain Regen, and maybe even more than that whenever ultimate. He was casting his spells.
Zeus tried to get the ultimate on Kant, but he was already TPing out and was not enough. Like, this, it's not an Arcanum Scepter, Zeus ultimate, or anything like that, so you really just go for the standard HP plus minus magic resistant, and yeah, da control Saucy de Uyebki. Whatever that means.
It looks grumpy, and apparently it's for the DDoSers, so I assume Urshaker just giving him the right old middle finger, but we're still in this game, and Yellow Sub is still looking okay in it. Even though the Zeus was able to hold a lot of weight, and that fight goes better than it maybe should have for Lemon Dogs, after all is said and done, it's still a 5-man wipe, and still good for Yellow Sub. Yeah. The Lashrak is up to 23 Bloodstone charges.
And it all comes down to the Viper lacking just that tiny little tad of farming. But oh, talking about farming, I think farming is bad news here for that Lashrak, but he pops the BKB. He's just so tanky, there's everything just going on Stepcell at the moment. There's no Glimmer Cape, no nothing right now on him. Krilly is trying really the best. Jolem is being stunned, he has no BKB whatsoever. So much Enable Ring right now. Embarrass is healing up Octoricore, right? That's why this item is so strong at the moment. Jolem still trying to get him down. He's not dying. Stepcell dying directly there on the spot. The Lashrak is not going down. It's amazing how tanky that freaking horseman is.
The stream is really having a bad time right now. Looks like we might be getting back up and running now, but it was offline for about 30 seconds, so...
What? No. Maybe
yes,
for you.
It was. It was for at least half of the viewers, too. There was much picnic. It might just be Hitbox servers.
Yeah, no, not on my side.
I don't dropped frames.
My side is 100% right through. Don't know. Anyway, this whole thing ends up with the Roshan obviously being down, Hand of Midas on the crown. The cheese goes to the Spiritbreaker, who was the gem carrier all the time. Now that's Winter Vyvan's job. And yeah, the game is getting out of control now for Lemon Dogs. Even though they had quite some nice fights, it really comes down to the Viper not doing enough damage and the Zeus also hitting that half-life we've been talking about. It's just not enough. But top, again, Barash, number two. They really tried to get him. Eris Loco was the one initiating now. The Arcanum Scepter is flying out, and the Viper. It's all about Viper's damage right now. They have a Walrus Punch available, which they can use right now just to hold him in place, and that should be a kill. But he has, like, what? Yeah, suicide 20 charges. The Snowball is trying to reach the other fountain. Obviously, never gonna reach. In the meantime, they go in bottom, already destroyed the tier 3 tower. There's the Winter's Curse. No turnaround, Jarok. No, he uses the cheese. Going in, Netherstrike here on the Zeus, and the damage is absolutely real. If the Bloodseeker reaches him, he is pretty much dead. The buybacks are going through. Krilly is the one who uses it. The Zeus, does he even have buyback? No, he's 1,000 gold short. The racks are going down. Now Viper joined that fight finally with Krilly, but Krilly doesn't even get to use any spell before he's really going down. He makes double stun, but oh, beautiful Echo Slam into everybody, and now they're cleaning up here. What they need is the Bloodseeker right back from the Aegis, and that's, of course, really bad news. Viper run for the fountain, but Abyssal Blade holding him in place, and I think we're looking at the GG fight right here. Everybody's just blinking away from that Bloodseeker. He's an angry little fella. This is not going anywhere.
Yeah, Lemon Dogs fought well, but I think the biggest issue is that they just missed their timing window. In the last couple fights, Viper's tanky, sure, but he can't compare to the amount of damage that Lesh and Bloodseeker are putting out. And once the Zeus is down, the amount of damage that Lemon Dogs have is next to zero. They're going to lose two barracks here and probably the third, even though the tier 2 is standing up top. It's not going to be standing for much longer. And yeah, I think this is a good game well played.
The attack speed of the Spiritbreaker is just ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. But yeah, you said it already. Like, no buyback on that Zeus. BKB on and charge. Nope, that was just a fake little one, and in the end, they're gonna work on the racks, they're gonna make it here. Yeah, Mega Creeps. There's not much else to say. They're gonna clean up Krilly, there's just nothing he can do. Spike Carapace doesn't care about BKBs, and Eris Loco. 17% in your face, that felt like 3 in a row, and the Zeus just back from his little sleep in the fountain. He's just trying to get some kills, but in the end, Steph Style under the Winter's Curse, and that should also be the end of the Zeus, unless, nah, he's charged.
Well, looks like Zeus is going to survive for a little while longer, but he's going to be ruptured up, and that's the end of the line for Jarl, unless he can kill off Valak first. With the Ocarine Core sustaining, he'll be able to bolt down the Bloodseeker, but there's nothing they can do now, as that is good game called out by Sephstyle. Well played from Yellow Submarine. They were able to delay it long enough. That advantage at the end of the game got to pretty gross, but, well, a clean 12 even throughout so many pauses. Yellow Sub will come away with $300 more.
Yeah. I mean, it's too bad. Like, we never know. Like, the load changed, of course, the last good fight of London, Lemon Dogs, and that's always very unfortunate. But yesterday they kind of benefited of the load, and today it hit them. That's very unfortunate. Still, Yellow Submarine, they played very, very well in game one. There was no doubt that they were absolutely the winner that deserved it. This one, of course, was overshadowed by a lot of lag, DDoS, reload, whatever you want to call it. It doesn't really matter. The fact is, rules are rules. Same chances for everybody. They won also the second game. Make it a 2-0, guys. And that also means we are in a bit of a hurry, of course, because now we are going into 4 ASC versus a very interesting team. It's going to be Taco Live. It's 8-mother stack, and it's pretty much their debut in a reasonable tournament to show what their skills are. But of course, 4AAC, they're also very strong team, so let's see if this is gonna be an easy 2-0 run through, or if 4AAC actually will struggle against this team. Wonder if they are prepared. So my name is Heflamoke, and I'm casting here with Krennis. We I hope so far you enjoyed the show. Next game will be up shortly in just a tiny bit. Be right back.